Welcome to Physics 105, Lecture Chapter 19, Vibrations and Waves. This lecture will help you understand vibrations of a pendulum, wave description, wave speed, transverse and longitudinal wave, the interference of waves, standing waves, Doppler effect, bow, and shock waves. Okay, a vibration is a periodic wiggle in time. A periodic wiggle in both space and time is a wave. A wave extends from one place to another. Examples are light, which is an electromagnetic wave that needs absolutely no medium. Sound, which is a mechanical wave that needs a medium to travel through, such as air. A vibration, of course, is a wiggle in time. A wave is a wiggle in both space and time. If we suspend a stone at the end of a piece of string, we have a simple pendulum. The pendulum will swing to and fro at a rate that depends only on the length of pendulum in G. It does not depend upon the mass, just as mass does not affect the rate at which a ball falls to the ground. Now, you did this in the lab when we measured the gravity lab. Remember that? Okay, the time of one to and fro swing is called a period. And a complete swing is just that, this to that and back again. The longer the length of pendulum, the longer the period, the slower it swings. Just as the higher you drop a ball from, the longer it takes to reach the ground. It actually works as a square root of L over G. A 1 meter long pendulum has a bob with a mass of 1 kilogram. Suppose that that bob is now replaced with a different bob of mass 2 kilograms. How will the period of the pendulum change? Actually, it will not change at all because the period of the pendulum depends only on the length of the pendulum and on G, not on the mass. So changing the mass will do absolutely nothing. A 1 meter long pendulum has a bob with a mass of 1 kilogram. Suppose the bob is now tied to a different string so that the length of the pendulum is now 2 meters. How will the period of the pendulum change? It will increase. In other words, the pendulum will swing more slowly. It actually goes as the square root of L over G. Now, a wave is pictorially represented with a sine curve. A sine curve is obtained when you trace out the path of a vibrating pendulum over time. And here's an old-fashioned apparatus for doing this. You put some sand in this cup. This is the pendulum. And there's a hole down at the bottom of the cup that lets the sand dribble out. You set this pendulum to swinging. At the same time, you crank the crank that makes the paper move past this whole apparatus. The sand will drop through the hole in the pendulum on the sheet of paper as the paper moves past. And as the pendulum swings back and forth, this traces out a sine curve on the paper. And you can sort of see it there. There's a better picture of this in the next few slides. We can also take a vertical situation here, vertical paper that's going past this. We take a spring, suspend a weight from it, and we pull the spring down and let it vibrate back and forth as the paper sweeps by. There's a pen on this mass here that traces out a sine wave. Okay, so we're going to label some of the pertinent parts of the wave. There are the crests. The crests are the high points of the wave, and the troughs, as you probably guessed, are the low points of the wave. The amplitude is the distance from the midpoint to the crest or the midpoint to the trough. Doesn't matter which one, it's the midpoint. The midpoint is 1/2 between here and here, 1/2 the vertical distance between here and here. The wavelength is the distance from the top of one crest to the top of the next crest, or the distance between two successive troughs, or the distance like between this area, that place, and this place. Any two successive identical parts of the wave. Be very careful to identify identical parts of the wave. Now, how frequently a vibration occurs is called the frequency. And you can see that right there. It tells you exactly what it is. The unit for frequency is the hertz. HC is abbreviation. And this is named after Heinrich Hertz. The frequency of 1 hertz is a vibration that occurs once per second. In other words, 1 hertz is 1 vibration per second, also known as 1 cycle per second. Mechanical objects like pendulums, remember, if you remember in the lab, they had a frequency of about 1 hertz, 1 or 2 hertz. Sound has a frequency for human range of hearing. It's about 15 hertz to about 20,000. Cats can see up to 40,000, but the main part of human hearing is 100 to 1,000 hertz. Radio waves have frequencies of a few megahertz or million hertz. Cell phones operate at the gigahertz range, about 2.5 gigahertz, if I remember correctly. Wi-Fi is also pretty much in that same range. So do microwave ovens. Light is also a wave, and we'll talk more about that later, but light is an electromagnetic wave. Radio, cell, and light waves are all electromagnetic. Now, frequency specifies the number of to and fro vibrations in a given time. In other words, the number of complete cycles in a given time. It is also the number of waves passing any point per second. So, for example, two vibrations occurring in 1 second is a frequency of 2 hertz or two vibrations per second. The periods of time it takes to complete one vibration period is actually equal to 1/frequency, or frequency is equal to 1/period. And this is, of course, an inverse relationship. A pendulum makes two vibrations in 1 second. The frequency is 2 hertz. The period of the vibration is 1/2 second or 0.5 seconds. A sound wave has a frequency of 500 hertz. What is the period of vibration of the air molecules due to the sound wave? It is 1/500 or 0.002 seconds. If the frequency of a particular wave is 20 hertz, its period is 1/20 of a second or 0.05 seconds. It just 1/frequency. Now, waves actually transport energy, not matter. If you drop a stone in a quiet pond, resulting ripples will actually carry no water across the pond. People always think the water moves across the pond. It doesn't. The water molecules just go round and around little tiny circles as the wave passes. The wave carries the energy across the pond and the disturbance across the pond, but the water molecules themselves are just going in little circles. If you look at grass on a windy day or wheat on a windy day, you notice the grass or the wheat just waves back and forth as the ripples pass through the grass. Similarly, the molecules in air propagate a disturbance such as sound through the air, but the air molecules themselves just vibrate back and forth as the energy of the wave goes through them. Now, wave speed describes how fast a disturbance will move through a medium. It depends on the medium for mechanical waves like sound. In vacuum, it's constant for electromagnetic waves, but for electromagnetic waves in clear medium like glass, it depends upon the medium. It is related to the frequency and the wavelength of the wave, and wave speed equals frequency times wavelength. Or if we want to write that out in a formula, V equals F lambda. So for example, a wave with a wavelength of 1 meter and frequency of 1 hertz has a speed of 1 meter per second. Okay, a wave with a wavelength of 10 meters and a time between crest of 0.5 seconds is traveling in water. What is the wave speed? It's 20 meters per second. First thing you want to look at is frequency is 1/period, and that is 1/0.5 seconds or 2 hertz. The wave speed is the frequency times the wavelength. So the wave speed is 2 hertz times 10 meters or 20 meters per second. There are two types of waves, transverse and longitudinal. And these differ because of the direction in which the medium vibrates compared to the direction of travel. This is a longitudinal wave. This is a transverse wave. Okay, so we'll do transverse waves first. For a transverse wave, the medium vibrates perpendicular to the direction of energy transfer or wave travel. Transverse means perpendicular. So it's sort of like a slinky, and you stretch out the slinky and you shake it back and forth. Okay, the wave goes to the right here. The direction of the energy transport is also to the right, but the wiggle in the spring is back and forth, perpendicular to the wave travel, perpendicular to the energy transport. It's a side-to-side movement. Now, strings and musical instruments, if you look very carefully, sometimes you can see them vibrating, and they vibrate this way. Any electromagnetic wave, like radio, light, will also be a transverse wave. And the S waves in earthquakes are also transverse waves. The distance between adjacent peaks and the direction of travel for a transverse wave is its wavelength. And you can use peaks or troughs or between any adjacent identical parts of the waveform. The vibrations along a transverse wave move in a direction that is perpendicular to the wave, and that's what the word transverse means, is perpendicular. Okay, now longitudinal waves. The medium will vibrate parallel to the direction of energy transfer or wave travel, and basically is what happens. You take a slinky, instead of up and down here, you're wiggling it back and forth to the right and left. So what you get then is you get these compressions where the slinky is compressed, and between them you also get rarefactions where the slinky is stretched out. And examples of this are sound waves in solid, liquid, and gas, and the P earthquake waves. So remember, longitudinal waves, medium vibrates parallel, that is along the direction of energy transfer. Okay, so a longitudinal wave, there's an example, sound waves in solid, liquid, or gas, or P waves that travel, or earthquake waves that travel through the ground. P waves can travel in solid and liquids. Here's a picture of this. Okay, the wave is traveling down the tube to the right, and it consists of these compressions where the medium has been compressed to a higher density and higher pressure. And in between the compressions, there are the rarefactions where the medium is stretched out or expanded or decompressed into a lower pressure and lower density. Now, earthquakes can tell us what the earth is made of. There are two types of earthquake waves. One is a P wave. P waves can travel through both solids and liquids. The other is an S wave. S waves can only travel through solids. And we've been studying earthquakes for years. And we have a device called a seismometer, which measures P and S waves. And earthquakes occur constantly. The earth is constantly have earthquakes in various places all over. For instance, here's an earthquake site here. And the earthquake goes off, sends the waves through the earth, and the P waves travel everywhere. So all the seismometers all over the earth pick up the P waves. But the S waves only pick up the ones that go through solid material. So that allows us, for instance, right here, you see no S waves there. That tells us that there is something liquid inside the earth. And it allowed us to understand that the earth actually has a liquid outer core. It's made out of iron. And because of this, this iron core protects the earth, generates a strong magnetic field that protects the earth from the sun's radiation and also from cosmic radiations from supernova explosions. And ironically, the earth iron was made in stars when they went supernova. What causes stars to go supernova? The wavelength of a longitudinal wave is the distance between either the successive compressions or the successive rarefactions, or both. Now, wave interference occurs when two or more waves interact with each other because they occur in the same place at the same time. And the superposition principle says you can add up these disturbances. So the displacement due to an interference of wave is determined by adding the disturbances produced by each wave. So here are some examples of this. There's two basic types of interference. There's constructive interference and destructive interference. And the names of this are pretty descriptive of what they are. So here's constructive interference. Constructive interference occurs when the crest of one wave meets the crest of the other, and the trough meets the trough. So you can sort of add this up. You add this to that, you get this, a bigger wave. If you add this to that, you get a bigger trough. So this is called reinforcement. So the individual effects add together, produces a wave of increased amplitude. The waves are in phase with each other. And this is called constructive interference. Destructive interference, you've probably guessed, unless you read ahead, but you probably guessed, is when the crest meets the trough and the trough meets the crest. And then what happens is they kind of wipe each other out. Literally, they wipe each other out. So the high part of one wave fills in the low part of another, and you wind up with a cancellation. Now, this can produce either a wave of reduced or even zero amplitude. And in this case, the waves are out of phase with each other. Okay, now we can see an interference pattern made when two vibrating objects touch the surface of water. And the vibrating objects make the water vibrate, create waves here. Each one's creating its own pattern of waves. And the waves are interacting with each other to create this interference pattern. And parts of the wave have destructive interference in them. And that's the regions where a crest of one wave will overlap the trough of another to produce regions of zero or low amplitude. And at points along these waves are out of phase, so they arrive out of step with each other, and they wipe each other out. Constructive interference are regions where the crest of one wave meets the crest of another to produce regions of enhanced or added amplitude. And at points in these regions, the waves, of course, will arrive in steps and in phase with each other. If we tie a rope to a wall and shake the free end up and down, we can produce a train of waves in the rope. The easiest way to do this is take a doorknob, find a rope, tie the rope to the doorknob securely, and then close the door. And stand at the other end of the rope and shake it back and forth or up and down. Okay, the wall won't, or the doorknob won't shake. It's too rigid. So what happens is the waves get reflected back along the rope. As they meet this end, they get reflected back along the rope. If you get just the right frequency, you can cause the incident and reflective waves to reinforce each other and form a standing wave. Now, the parts of the standing wave are the nodes. This is a node. It's a region where there is minimal or zero displacement with minimum or zero energy. The antinodes, as you probably guessed, are the places where you have the maximum displacement and maximum energy. And these occur equally apart from each other. So for instance, this would be a quarter wave here, another quarter wavelength, another quarter wavelength, another quarter wavelength. So they're all equally spaced. So here we go. We're tying a rope to a firm support. We shape this back and forth. If you shake the rope with the right frequency, you set up a standing wave. This one is the fundamental frequency. That's the lowest frequency you can get. That is also called the first harmonic. If you shake the rope with twice the frequency that you had for this one, you end up with a standing wave of half the wavelength. See, there's twice as much in here as there was there. So you have two loops, and this is the second harmonic. If you shake the rope with three times the frequency, you wind up with a thing that looks like this. It's a standing wave of one-third the wavelength of what the original one was, has three loops, and this is called the third harmonic. This kind of reinforcement and standing waves, this is what makes musical instruments loud. We set up standing waves in these to make them sound the way they do. Now, you've probably stood on the side of the road as a truck or a vehicle went by, or maybe you listened to a train blowing its whistles as it went past a train crossing. You probably heard this effect. Okay, where it drops as the vehicle goes by. This is called the Doppler effect. This occurs because there's a relative motion between the observer and the sound source. So it occurs when a vibration source is moving with respect to an observer, or observers moving with respect to the vibration source. And it doesn't just occur with light, it occurs with any wave. Okay, so suppose you got this truck here, two observers here, the truck is not moving with respect to either one. And so nobody observing anything except just the original sound. Here the truck is moving. This observer, the truck is moving toward this observer and away from this one. So if you look at this observer over here on the right, the distance between the source and the observer is decreasing. So this means the observed vibrations, this guy's going to hear these vibrations at a higher frequency, and he's going to have a shorter, they're going to have a shorter wavelength. So the sound will be the higher pitch sound, that part. For light, because this is going to occur with light too, this would be a blue shift. So it's shifted to a shorter wavelength, higher frequency. In this observer here, the truck is moving away from this observer. And so therefore, the distance between the source and the observer is increasing. And then the observed vibrations are lengthened to a longer wavelength. And with sound, we would hear the lower pitch, that the lower pitch. And with light, we would have a red shift, okay, to a longer wavelength, lower frequency. And this, as you probably guessed, can be used to actually, if we can measure this, and we do, we can use this to determine relative motion between the observer and the source. The Doppler effect also applies to light. The increase in light frequency is called a blue shift, and that occurs when the light source is approaching you. The decrease in light frequency is called a red shift, and that occurs when the light source is moving away from you. This is used to measure the relative speed between the observer and the source, and a cop's radar gun works like this. If you are measuring, if you're a baseball player and you want to measure your pitch speed, how fast you throw the ball, they use a radar gun to do that. And it uses the Doppler effect to do that. So it's used to measure, also used to measure the motions of stars and galaxies. And it's actually was used to discover the universe expanding. And the source of that expansion is the Big Bang. The original thing that caused the universe, set the universe in motion was the Big Bang. Star's spin speed can also be determined by shift measurement. So if you look at the light from a spinning star, part of the star is moving toward you. And that light is blue shifted to shorter wavelengths, higher frequency. The other part of the star is moving away from you. And that light is shifted toward longer wavelengths, red shifted toward longer wavelengths, lower frequency. The same star will have both things going on at the same time. Because remember, it's spinning. Okay, the Doppler effect of light, blue shift is an increase in light frequency toward the blue end of the spectrum. Red shift is a decrease in light frequency toward the red end of the spectrum. As I mentioned before, a rapidly spinning star will show a red shift on the side moving away from us and a blue shift on the side moving toward us. We can actually measure the amount of shift to determine how fast the star is spinning. Okay, the Doppler effect occurs for both A and B. Okay, it will work for both light and sound. Okay, now bow waves. If you've ever watched a ship go by or watched something traveling through the water on the surface of the water, you've probably have seen a bow wave and maybe you didn't even know what it was. Well, here's where you get to learn that. It occurs when the source is moving through a medium at the same or at a greater speed as the waves that it's producing by its motion. And what this does is it causes a wave barrier. So you can picture something moving through the water. It is generating waves by its motion. If it is moving at the speed of those waves, you can kind of imagine that the waves can't move faster than the speed that they're supposed to move at, but the source is moving at that speed or at a greater speed. So the source keeps moving and it ends up making these waves pile up in the front of the source. And this produces kind of a wall. This also happens with aircraft. The aircraft is flying faster than the speed of sound. It ends up making a bow wave, making a V-shaped form of overlapping waves when the object is traveling faster than the wave speed. If you increase the speed, you probably notice this with boats too. If you increase the speed, this V of the bow waves gets narrower because this object is now outracing the speed of the waves. Now, in an aircraft, this produces a shockwave that we call a sonic boom. And it's a pattern of overlapping spheres that form a cone from objects traveling faster than the speed of sound. The cone actually is this double thing here. Okay, so this shockwave consists of two cones. One is the high-pressure cone, generate the bow of the supersonic aircraft or whatever is going faster than the speed of sound. The other is the low-pressure cone that follows close to the tail of the aircraft. And as this passes by you, okay, so this aircraft is moving past you, you get this pulse here, high pressure here, and then a low pressure here. And that's that sound, that sonic boom that you hear. Now, the aircraft itself doesn't have to be making any sound. Okay, it just has to be moving at a speed that's faster than the speed of sound in the air. And the sonic boom doesn't just have to occur from aircraft. It occurs anytime you have something moving faster than the speed of sound through air, you'll get a boom. You hear it as a sharp cracking sound. And the intensity is due to the overpressure and underpressure of the atmospheric pressure between the two cones of the shockwave. And that's this right here. This is the overpressure and underpressure. And it's produced continuously as long as the object is supersonic. Now, as I mentioned before, you don't have to have an aircraft. Anything that moves faster than the speed of sound is going to make a sonic boom, a crack. And if you've ever heard a whip crack, that crack is a sonic boom. A bullet traveling faster than the speed of sound will make the same thing. And here is a picture of this. Here is the bow wave. That's that cone on the bow, the tip, forward part of this bullet. Here is the stern wave, a little harder to see. The stern wave is trailing off this back end here. Okay, that is this trailing cone here. That's this right here. Here is also something very interesting. This pressure drop can be so severe that when the air, it causes the air to cool very rapidly. And that will form either fog, and even in extreme cases, it can form actually ice crystals. And you can actually see the fog here. This is a very low pressure area between this right in here. That's this right here. A wiggle in time is called a vibration. A wave is a vibration in both space and time. When we consider how frequently a pendulum swings to and fro, we're talking about, now the word here is frequently. So you're talking about its frequency. When we consider the time it takes for a pendulum to swing to and fro, we're talking about the pendulum's period. When we consider how far a pendulum swings back and flow, we're talking about the amplitude. The frequency of a wave is the inverse of its period. So F equals 1 over T, or T equals 1 over F, where F is the frequency and T is the period. If the frequency of a particular wave is 20 hertz, it's period is 1/20th of a second, or 0.05 seconds. It's just 1 over frequency. In Europe, the electric razor completes 50 vibrations in 1 second. The frequency of this is 50 hertz with a period of 1/50th of a second. For a transverse wave, the distance between adjacent peaks and the direction of travel is its wavelength. And remember, a transverse wave is one that wiggles perpendicularly to the direction of travel. If you dip your finger repeatedly into the surface of still water, you will produce waves. The more frequently you dip your finger, the higher the wave frequency and the shorter the wavelengths. The speed of a wave can be found by multiplying its frequency by its wavelength. So V equals F times lambda. The vibrations of a transverse wave move in a direction that's perpendicular to the wave's direction of travel. The vibrations of a longitudinal wave will move in the direction of the wave's direction of travel. You can easily remember longitudinal is along the wave's travel. A common example of a longitudinal wave is sound. Wave interference occurs for any of these or all of these. A standing wave is produced by reflective waves undergoing interference. A Doppler effect is characteristic of both sound and light waves. A Doppler effect is concerned with changes in waves frequency. Be careful with this. We got to distinguish between how fast the wave is moving and how frequently it wiggles. Also distinguish between the wave speed and the speed of the object or observer. A sonic boom and a bow wave are two examples of shock waves. And shock waves occur whenever an object moves at a speed that is greater than the wave speed for the medium which is traveling through. A sonic boom cannot be produced by aircraft flying slower than the speed of sound. Okay, thank you very much. Please make sure you do your homework, read the book, check your notes, okay, review. And there are the odd number questions at the back of the chapters. Odd number questions at the back of the chapters are answered in the back of the book. So if you need more practice, it's a good time to do it.